Mini Chapter 90. Kim shames Ashley. Jaymi wanders along the railing past the kidney-shaped pool behind the house on Jupiter Drive. He reaches the well-swept but seldom-used flight of 10 steps leading down off this terrace to the precipitous slope beneath. He descends the flight, sits on the 8th step, and places his feet down on the 10th one, with the ends of his bare toes at the lowest rind of manicured civilization, before that other realm begins. The original realm of untamed earth and scrub, steep and scratchy, where the savage scraping of hidden bugs emanates from spiny clumps of grass, evidencing an alien but atavistically familiar world of mandibled murder, kept at bay by artificial means. His first response to seeing Bangdad's new cozy score, normal comfy or strange scary newsfeed, was to start creating Scorpio's code out of thin air, beginning with nothing but a forecho of this beast's fierce beauty. If the ones and zeros behave themselves, Scorpio will soon emerge from his code. He'll be painted with his own visuals, which will animate him. He'll be scored with his own soundtrack, which will come alive, and he'll be tested. Then, within a few days, he'll be electrified into incarnated form in all his beauty like a burst of love. But despite this creation cycle of Scorpio, there is little clarity as to how the cozy score, normal comfy or strange scary newsfeed could possibly fail to barrel upwards and outwards in popularity and profitability around the world, at least for as long as tabloid culture outsells the rest. There can be no assurance of the success of any investment, but a media stream that facilitates the rating of bite-sized life philosophy memes for reassuringness, using Ain't They Freaky's Freakometer from a highest score of 10 for most normal comfy down to a lowest score of 1 for most strange scary by members of the public, does at least start out with the benefit of appealing to the resources of a decent majority. Incarnated into the world by themselves, those bursts of Scorpio love would stand no chance against such competition. But with a little backup, perhaps they might survive after all. What on earth can Jaymi do, though, to give them any backup? Maybe nothing whatsoever, really, against such a gigantic, streaming wall of dreary, intellectually soggy deadweight. No, he can do what he can, whatever that may be. He can send out something beautiful and rich in response to that deluge. A tiny thing in the face of a giant thing, yes, as before, but it's worth a shot, is it not? Or, more accurately, not just one tiny thing, but five. His five incarnated beasts, sent out to wreak havoc, to do the work of the angels out in meat space. All he needs to do is identify their mission, with a view to undermining Bangdad's output from within. Ever since Evelyn surprised him by constructing her suspended pig's ribcage sculpture in Westmont, without his knowing she was doing so, however, it has been made clear to Jaymi on several occasions that once a beast has been incarnated and let loose into the world, his awareness of what they get up to is incomplete at best. His phone rings. Hello, he answers, gazing down at that circle of hairy-trunked palm trees with the long-ago bonfire traces in the clearing at their centre. Jaymi, this is Kim. I'm sure you're super busy, so I'll keep this quick. I just wanted to say that I found myself becoming quite attracted, in a platonic way, of course, to a certain quality in Ashley, a quality that I can only describe as a certain blonde seriousness. Oh, geez, says Jaymi, resting his head in his hand. You may have to think fast here, to stop something going off the rails. This beast has clearly become a loose cannon. Is incarnation making the beasts too independent? No, hear me out, says Kim. I'm a serious-minded blonde myself, as you'll know from creating me, so it was natural for me to give her a call and go round to visit her at the Century Park East apartment. In fact, I'm there now. Oh, geez, this is all we need. Kim, please. It'll only make for unforeseen complications, not to mention loose variables. Quite the opposite, I'm happy to say. I asked her if I could visit her because I could see what a thoughtful and principled woman she is. So I wondered how she could bring herself to work as such an indispensable part of Ain't They Freaky. It didn't make sense. So I told her it didn't. I explained what huge, insidious damage the game's tabloid culture does to people across the world, how it cheapens them, demeans them, and drags them down with such power. For 10 minutes, I talked about all that, and then about what you're making. Then I shut up and just stared at her. Her first response was to argue, but I could tell it was faint-hearted argument. Then she petered out, went quiet, and almost started crying. Then, when she next spoke, it was to offer to help you in your missions while she continues working at Bangdad. Would you like to speak with her? She's sitting beside me. Well, sure. Okay, I'll hand over to her. Here she comes. Jaymi closes his eyes and listens to the muffled sound of the phone being passed from hand to hand, while a farcical idea occurs to him that Kim may, just conceivably, be all alone and on the point of doing a high-camp vocal impersonation of Ms. Tweak. A helpless, hysterical hoot of mirth threatens to force its way up through Jamie's body and burst out, but is swiftly diffused by the intimation of a headache behind his left eye. "Hi, Jaymi, this is Ashley," says a tightly wound female voice into his ear. He decides this is not Kim, but the genuine article herself. "Ashley! Well, well, well. Yes, indeed. So, how are things?" "Jaymi, I want to confirm everything Kim just said. You have created the most amazing, pure-minded character in him. What a beautiful soul he is. That in itself has played a part in my decision, I don't mind telling you. He's made me see what I've always known, but have chosen to ignore, that I'm doing harm by working on Ain't They Freaky, because that whole tabloid culture does such damage. So I'm doing that damage. I'm damaging people. And that is not what I, Ashley Tweak, want to have done to the world for this little short time I'm in it. So I'm going to atone for that. Kim's filled me in on what you're up to and how you're trying to counteract Ain't They Freaky. I'd like to help you instead." She stops, awaiting a reaction from Jaymi, who sits there at a loss to know how to respond. At last he says, "You'll understand my asking if there's anything that might give me assurance Dad hasn't put you up to this?" "Fair question. All I can say is, try me. If there's something specific I can do from within the company that would help you, then ask me, and I'll see if I can do it. But only in the strictest secrecy, of course. I don't want to be arrested for facilitating industrial espionage." "Right, nor me. Okay, then. Well, are you free to come to my place on Electra Drive tomorrow evening, after dinner time, for drinks?" "Yes, I'd love to, thanks." "One question. Can Kim come, too?" Jaymi laughs out loud. "Yes, of course, he's welcome to come over. He is, after all, the embodiment of my own blonde seriousness of mind, despite my not even being blonde. In fact, what am I saying? Kim even lives there on Electra Drive, with Shigim and Evelyn in the guest wing, so he'll already be around when you arrive. Though I am careful to allow the three of them their privacy, so I don't tend to go knocking on the guest wing door to visit them." "Oh, what an absurdly exciting but cosy arrangement that sounds like," bubbles Ashley, emitting a high-strung, frisky giggle down the phone line. "Well, yeah, you know, we muddle through," says Jaymi. Then without warning, he becomes aware that he's blushing, just as Shigim and he so prominently blushed throughout their teens, almost every time another person stared at them. But this time he's alone, at the bottom of this furthest flight of steps down and out into the untamed canyon, sitting by himself, while his cheeks burn hot and pink and bright beyond control. "Okay then, see you tomorrow night," says Ashley. "Great, let's say 8:30. Give me a call from outside the gates and I'll let you in." He terminates the call, then punches the air in triumphal satisfaction, proclaiming aloud to himself, "Yay, 2 dreary ones converted, 2 to go. Ace!" Subsiding from this vocal bravado, he puts the phone away. His gaze melts into the distant haze of the city. He raises both hands to his face, and with the lightest of pressure, he lays his fingers against both his cheeks, barely touching the skin. And through all 8 fingertips, he can feel the relentless, lifelong throb of Shigem's teenage vulnerability, pressing pink and warm and shy just beneath the surface.